Hello everyone, this is GT Time. I'm your moderator, Kyle Bossman, and joining us as always is our uniquely talented and knowledgeable panel, including Brandon Jones.
Take a breath.
And Daniel Bloodworth.
That sounds like you're about to run out of air.
And Michael Damiani.
Gotta soak up that Damiani time.
We're soaking this up. Damiani, how many more shows do we have with you before you leave?
Two.
Yeah, this and two more.
Oh, wow.
Dos.
The final three.
Dos equis.
Are there things, I was genuinely curious about this. I was thinking about this. Are there things you want to say on camera before you leave?
7.8.
All right, we'll cover it. On your last GT time, we're gonna have like a whole space where Damiani just gets to speak his piece, say everything he wants on camera, point at directly at the audience and say anything he wants. Deal?
Damiani cool. Time.
Can we shoot like a joke bit afterwards in my office? Where we pretend it's like 3 weeks later, I'm like still here.
Yeah, we can.
And you're like, Kyle comes in and you're just like,
it's not gonna work because
hey,
we're describing the whole thing.
Do you remember,
right now.
Damiani, when you like said all that stuff on camera and then you didn't, you're still here? You're gonna be like,
This is really sad. I don't know if I should bring this up. On the radio, they were talking about guys who had HIV in the 80s were spending their money ridiculously, and then they found ways to keep you alive if you have HIV, and now they have no money left for retirement. It's kind of like that. You know what? I should not have.
What?
It'd be like that. Like Damiani's like, hey, I'm gonna say all these things. I'm gonna get this all out there, and it's like, wait, Damiani, you're still here. Okay. Oh boy. Okay. Oh boy. Let's start.
Do you want to talk about police officers next? I mean, what are we going
to? Yeah, man. Wow.
Let's start corrections music. Okay, so corrections music. Advanced Warfare was not a flawless launch, especially on PC, is what the commenters wanted us to know.
Oh, that was my bad.
Kind of, yeah. I mean, I had problems even with a few matches, but I'd say it worked well. It wasn't flawless, but I'd say it worked very well, especially considering.
Brandon's quote did come from pre-launch.
And I was technically
that was their statement that they had made.
And I was
pre-launch.
Quoting Activision that that's something that they, well, Sledgehammer specifically, that that's something that they said.
They wouldn't stand for it, were your words.
And the general point that I was making is that Call of Duty is not a franchise that when you think of them, you're like, oh, they always be, you know, totally, you know, botched.
Although, well, I'm bringing up the PC. I think the PC players may have an issue with that.
They're
as
very,
well.
And that franchise is very neglected.
There's very much a sense that Call of Duty is no longer a PC franchise.
And corrections music. great.
It's pretty light on corrections for the week.
We did pretty okay last week. We did all right.
Nice.
Damiani wasn't here to spew out some trolling.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Now you're going to need to go back and look at all the corrections ever and attribute points to how many people had the most.
It's definitely me. I've made the most mistakes out of anyone.
Oh. I was gonna say, like, after he's gone from the show, you can get rid of.
Do we have a reset
the
after the year
entirely?
End? How does it
yeah,
work?
Yeah, I think we're gonna have to reset. I think we're gonna have to, like, especially our points, our scoreboard. I think it's gotta reset
for wins.
Yeah.
Ooh.
So maybe like we give Damiani or whoever's in first
season
a prize.
Two.
I Bloods in first.
So you have season two, right?
Ooh. Got 3 weeks.
I don't know if we can catch you in 3 weeks. We'll get to that later. Let's talk about video game news. Let's talk about like
let's
the purpose
that.
Of this podcast. You know I love game announcements. We had a sort of game announcement this week. frankly, a leak. It was a leak. Assassin's Creed Victory was unintentionally announced this week. Ubisoft owned up to it and said, yeah, that's real. That sucks. That,
oh,
that's
they owned
out.
Up to it, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, okay, Damiani, hold on. We'll get to you first. I should describe what this is to anyone who isn't familiar with what's going on. Kotaku ran an article, said, hey, we know someone at Ubisoft, they showed us this video. The next Assassin's Creed will be called Assassin's Creed Victory, and you will see it in Victorian England.
I actually have something relevant I'm gonna try to find, just keep talking.
Okay, it will be 8th gen only, and there will be no 360 PS3 version of this game. This is going to be it. They're all in.
Or 360 PS3 Assassin's Creed, period.
Right. Ubisoft Quebec is making this game and has been for a while. Damiani, you seem to think, here's what I'm pulling from you. I think you think this is an intentional leak.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think that's
whatever
what you're trying
you
to imply
that.
Here.
Okay. Oh, you ready
ahead,
for this?
Read,
okay.
Read.
This is from a data log. In Assassin's Creed Rogue in the whole Abstergo Entertainment fake video game company office.
Wait. Tell me a little more about that. What do you mean? So you like you were in the game and
so you
like,
walk around the office, you repair computers, and then you see files. And I think this actually comes from like somebody left their iPad on the ground or something like that.
Okay.
It says security. This past year has seen many leaks of internal information get out to the public. Do not speak about your work with fellow travelers on airplanes, for example. Do not engage the so-called entertainment press without a PR representative with you.
That is hilarious.
Inside of Assassin's Creed Rogue, which was also leaked.
You should have tweeted that. You absolutely
I did tweet it. That's why I pulled it up.
That's very, very, very funny. Oh my gosh. And so it happened again. Presumably the same exact contact who leaked those things to Kotaku last year.
Yeah. Stealth ops.
What is the deal with this person?
Oh, they're paid to do this.
They're paid to leak information?
Yeah, this is a controlled leak.
Why would they leak it right now? One. What do they stand to gain from this?
To get everyone's attention off Unity and look at Victory. Like, hey guys, remember everyone kept saying like, oh, Victorian London, that'd be a cool setting. It'd been rumored along with Japan forever. So it's like, hey, we're actually working on it. Man, Unity is getting a lot of flack right now and stuff. Like, we offered, like, you know, we got rid of the season pass. We're going to give people a free game. You know, we're going to give the next DLC for free. But, man, what if we got them talking about, like, the next game? Because, you know, every time we make, like, a one that's borked, the next one's usually good. Like, 3 was screwy, but 4 was really good. So Unity was, that's like, you funny. Know, borked. So this one's going to be amazing. So let's get people talking about it right now. Let's get, like, let's, like, take control of the discussion
Assassin's Creed. Review, borked.
Borked's a great word.
I honestly think that there is somewhat of a chance that there's going to be an announcement at Game Awards tonight.
And they wanted to preempt it?
Well, but that's how it gets out. Like, cause, like, well, is it just within the developers? I mean, like, because these things are being worked on for years and years and years. Like, that stuff stays secret. People want to keep their jobs or whatever. It's when it starts getting out to kind of the fringes of, like, the marketing team, and then they start emailing more external people, and then, like, that's when the leaks seem to be happening.
Brandon, do you think there's anything honestly to gain from announcing next year's game 1 month after this year's game has been for sale?
Yeah, I remember what Damiani said.
No, it's been out for a month. You still want to sell the old game. You still want to sell Unity.
Yeah, but you're still releasing commercials that are not focusing on any of the glitches or any of the bad press or anything like that. So, like, you're still marketing the game. It's not like they pulled marketing entirely from Unity.
I think it would, I mean, if that was the intended effect, it just would totally backfire because people are so fatigued with Assassins right now.
Yeah.
To like, oh, here's the next. It's like, oh gosh.
All right, I guess.
On the other hand, I don't think it's the best way to announce victory at all.
Like, yeah,
I think it's the worst way to announce it. Actually,
this basically my follow up is like, if that was an evil machination, did it work?
Because Ubisoft keeps screwing up. It's a bad idea.
But like, does this bring goodwill? Are you all? Is anyone here excited about victory?
No, I don't think it's to do anything about goodwill, but I think this is one of the locations that people have been, like, asking for.
Yeah, it looks like Brandon's on board.
And, like, everything I kept reading about was like, oh, can't wait to see Jack the Ripper now. I can see, like, Jack the Ripper in Assassin's Creed. Like, you have a showdown mission where you assassinate Jack the Ripper, or maybe Jack the Ripper's a Templar or something. I was like, oh, here we go. Like, it's beginning. Here it goes. Like, people are, like, getting obsessed with the time period and stuff. Can't wait to scale Big Ben and stuff. It's going to be amazing. Like, here we go.
I just want the period to have a little bit more effect on the character and gameplay. Like, how many times have we gotten the same sleep, berserk, whatever, darts? And like, this is a new weapon, it does the same thing all the past 3 weapons have done.
You mean the blade you can shoot out your hand? What are you referring to?
There's sleep, berserk, and then like something else. But yeah, there's the set of darts. You know, and it's like one time it's a sniper rifle, another time it's a blowgun, another time it's something else. You know, it's like, it's the same mechanic. They're just throwing different things at it. Poison, I think, was when it was introduced. You could, like, put it on the tip of your blade.
Brandon.
Yeah?
Damiani thinks you are foolish for being excited about this game.
Well, you're just putting words in Damiani. I want to hear it from Damiani. Am I foolish for enjoying?
Wait, they said it was foolish?
Yeah, your words were foolish. You said, my boss, Brandon Jones, is foolish for being excited about.
Can we run back the tape? I'd like to see these words.
What excites you about the prospect of next year playing a game in Victorian England?
I love these games. These games are fun. I enjoy Assassin's Creed games. I personally will allow everybody to... You Pokemon. Like, I don't... If they announce, like, another Pokemon game, it's like, another one? And like, right. yeah, this one's on an island. Like, oh, an island. I bet there's little villages, and you go. Like, I could do that voice for anything. Like, you know. But it's like, I know you love that franchise. So it's like, cool. I'm happy for you that you get to play another one. That's great. You know, like, what if you get Pokemon game every year, every 2 years?
It's every year now.
Every year.
Yeah.
Well, I told you that earlier this year. It's like, Pokemon's every year now. That's kind of weird.
I was thinking on Twitter this week. It's Nintendo's only annual franchise is Pokemon.
Are you sad you get one every year? When they announce the next one, are you like, wait, too soon? I don't want to play more Pokemon right now.
Pokemon's such a huge game to me. Like, that is too, that's like craziness. Like, I would never get through a Pokemon game that quickly.
Brandon, you really spoke to me with this analogy. I gotta be honest.
I love this franchise. Yeah. I am not apologetic for loving this franchise and for liking more. It's like, they put in another era. It's like, oh, same game, different era. It's like, that's the franchise. That's what they do. They make a game, they put in another era, you bring in more characters. It's great. Like, I don't know. I throw away
more of the main story arc.
That is one thing that they definitely need to do, is they need to root it more in a through line and not just kind of like loosely connect the Abstergo stuff.
No, they need to get rid of any Abstergo stuff.
But I mean, there has to be a reason why you're doing this. There has to be a reason.
Just be in Victorian England. Be that. Be that person. Don't be the person who's imagining he's inside of that person.
By getting away from that stuff, they've just made it more late. Like, what, Unity, you're a guy playing a video game?
Or a girl.
As a guy playing a video game.
You're a person playing a video game.
Yeah. It's
and you were just saying you're like you're finding bugs on computers in Rogue.
You're repairing computers because accessing this guy's memories unleashed the virus through whatever.
That is your job in that game.
But Rogue was more tied to Black Flag.
Yeah, Rogue had a little really bit like more tied to things.
Here's my big question. Let's say you are Kotaku.com.
Right.
Someone from Ubisoft says, I got a video you're not going to believe. Shows you this video. Are you obligated to post a whole story about it?
Obligate isn't a strong word.
Should you do it? Should you leak this game against proper Ubisoft's will because you consider it news?
I say no, because I'm the editor-in-chief and founder of GameTrailers.com. I say let the trailer do it. The trailers are better at announcing anything than anybody. So I view that less as, you know, being like, oh, this is important, you guys need to know this. It's like, nobody got fired here. Nobody's like, you know, nobody's rights were violated. You know, there's no, it's just, you steal the headline. This is being like, oh, okay, we'll just yank that from you. We stole that headline because we just happened to talk to the right person.
But I mean, Kotaku reported it, but they weren't the source, right?
They were the source.
They were the source.
Yep.
Okay.
And they didn't just post like a paragraph thing. It's like tons of screenshots. It's like preview. It's a preview of Assassin's Creed Victory. And
it's a little weird.
Preview is fair because it uses words like innovate the gameplay, innovate the combat. Hmm. It uses kind of hopeful language that you would find in a preview as opposed to a news post, a report. And to me, that's where it comes in, where it's just like this person from Ubisoft, your Ubisoft contact, familiar with the goings on, I think they say. Probably is saying just like, and don't be too mean about it. You know what I mean? Here's this video, but like, I want to maintain this relationship. Don't you, Kotaku? And Kotaku's like, yes, please give us more scoops. Damiani, is that right or wrong?
I don't think that's the dialogue that happened.
What was the dialogue that happened?
I'm more pessimistic about that. If you're writing it like that, I feel like Kotaku was like, it was more of a business exchange. Like, we're going to give you this exclusive information. You're gonna post exactly what we like say about it, and you're gonna get like this scoop where you get to like reveal like this brand new Assassin's Creed game, and everyone's gonna have to come to your page and stuff and get all the clicks and stuff, and you're gonna benefit from that, and you just like use the language we want you to use, and we're all good with it. You know, you can do this. However, on the point of, so this is where I think it's tricky. I think if you are a game journalist, revealing the existence of games is part of your job. And as sucky as it is for like a person who likes to see a game get a grand unveiling as it was meant, I think you are obligated, if you learn of and confirm the existence of something, you should report on it. Holding it back means that you are playing bias to the publisher or developer by helping them protect their thing. Like, you're not being indifferent.
That's the side I can see.
The flip side is, in this situation, that's why I'm pessimistic, I feel this was a controlled leak, which means now you are being still being biased to the publisher, but you're being favorable to them, and that you're like revealing their game, but like you're not using any like negative language. As you said, they were using very hopeful, very typical preview-esque language.
Beaming about the graphics engine. It's really strange.
Like
it wasn't.
There was like no tone. It's a like, oh, Unity, like, you know, like was the change of setting enough to, you know, address the issues that Unity have, or, you know, is this series is coming, like, is yearly installments too? Like, there's no like language that challenged or questioned what they saw. It was just like presented it. They didn't even present it as is. It presented it in like a more positive light. So on that side, like, yeah, I would feel you're obligated, like, if they went to you and go, here's Unity, here's a victory. This is a new game, we want you to say this. I would have been like, you know what? You just told me about this, I will agree to talk about it, but I'm not gonna agree to say what you want me to say. And if you're not okay with that, then we won't run this story, so we don't, you know, at the very least, that's like as far as I'd go. But otherwise, like, if we're publishing this, we get to say what we want about what we just saw, like this trailer, these screenshots. I think if you're going by like journalism standards, like that's kind of what you have to do. So,
Daniel Bloodworth, it's me, Shady McGinnis.
Okay.
I work for Ubisoft. I got a scoop you're never gonna believe. Will you take it?
Yeah, I mean it's weird because it definitely like it puts perspective in like how what we do is kind of different than. Yeah, like the on the ground reporting type of thing. Yeah,
that's
like
true. We don't really
like
deal
a
Planet with that.
GameCube movie is like, yeah, we got the freaking first shot of the GameCube logo, and that was awesome, you know, and like we snuck that photo out there, you know, and it was.
Wait, I'm sorry. Can you tell us more about that story?
I think it was just like, yeah, they were just like wandering the halls at E3 and got the shot of what the GameCube logo looked like before.
So this is the year 2000.
Something like that. I forget exactly what the context was, but yeah, it's like we got a hold of it somehow.
Okay, you took a picture with a digital camera.
But I guess so.
Posted it online, and that was like Planet. What? Sorry.
Planet GameCube.
Planet GameCube was your site.
Yeah, it's Nintendo World Report now.
Oh, okay. But Planet GameCube had the first shot of the GameCube logo.
Yeah, and they you know they'd always go to E3 kind of early and like get the little behind the scenes shots.
I'm not cool with any of this, man. I'm not cool with any of this.
You spoiled it.
What about Overwatch? What about Overwatch? What if you had found out about Overwatch right before BlizzCon?
Yeah.
What if you just had a friend who was just like, oh my god, you know what they're gonna announce? It's called Overwatch. It's like, oh, here, bring up stuff on my phone. You're telling me you're obligated to like go to the internet and be like, here, Overwatch, and Blizz is like. And it's like, that would have made Huber and Ben more happy. They'd be like, oh, that would have been so great.
But I mean, as a...
Because you don't want Ben Moore and Mike Huber to have to bow to BioWare. They're not bowing to BioWare, they love BioWare. They want BioWare to make that announcement. They want BioWare to have their own party, get up on stage and say, we've been working really hard on this project, it's time for us to share it with you. It's this weird love-hate relationship with publishers. We love them when they make cool games, but when they don't, it's like, we can do whatever we want to. We can steal your ideas, we can take stuff, we can, you know, hack your emails, we can do whatever we want just because we don't like what you did this year. Ridiculous.
I love this. We got two ends of the couch. Gamiani wants to talk journalism.
I know things now. I know things I could say right now on this show and piss tons of people off.
It's my
obligation to say that.
No. There's two. If you are a game journalist, you call yourself a game journalist. Your job is to do actual journalistic work. You learn about something. Yes, your job is to serve the public interest and serve public information. It does not matter if you ruin some publisher's like big thing, because you're not serving the publishers. You're not like their.
This is the FBI. I didn't sign an oath. Like, I don't understand.
Unless you sign like an NDA or something, like that's why they have NDAs, is to prevent that type of stuff from happening, because they don't trust like, you know, average Joe to like keep a secret. If they ask it, like if a company asks you to do something, and they don't make you sign something as a journalist, then you like that's the like the moral quandary. Do you report on this now because you're not legally bound to shut up about it? You could say something about it.
Yeah.
And there's other things to weigh. Like, I think what I can liken what you said, like, you ruin, like, Overwatch. Like, you ruin that surprise. That's just entertainment. It could ruin the hype for it. I don't know if there was any, like, money that would, be suffered from that. But it's, like, not, like, an issue of national security. Like, when you learn of something that could, like, cost people lives and stuff, like, you know, get people killed.
Of course.
And, like, a president or, like, you know, the government goes, hey, can you hold off on publishing the story? Because you will endanger lives. I think that's the only time a journalist has to, like, seriously consider, like, not publishing a report. Because do you weigh the, like, value of life more than, like, serving public interest? In game journalism, which is, like, I use that term loosely, you don't need, like, there's no reason you should hold back on anything. Like, if you learn of something and you can verify it with a credible source, you should report on it.
Why should you report on Assassin's Creed Victory? Why should you publish this story?
Because it's the existence of a game. Because you're there to report on, like, game news. A new game is news. So the existence of a new game in a series, it means, like, hey, it should be obvious that they're always going to make another Assassin's Creed, but that's not always a given. They could stop making them. I mean, especially, I would also argue because of the, like, Unity's, like, shaky release and the bugs and stuff, it's like, wow, they're already working on this. Like, this trend is continuing. Like, it's more of the dialogue going along the lines of, like, the yearly Assassin's Creed. Should they, like, stop making these yearly? Look at what happened when they tried to do it again, and they made one on both, you know, console generations. This next one's going to only be on Xbox One, PS4, and presumably PC.
Yeah.
That's, like, part of the discussion, too. Hey, look, they're finally cutting ties with the old generation. Like, that's a bit of news right there, is that it's no longer going to be on Xbox 360, PS3. Maybe that was the reason they, like, you know, because they were stretching themselves too thin. Like, I don't know.
So you came in my office a month before you announced it on GT Time, and you told me you were moving to Texas.
Mm-hmm.
Was I obligated on the next GT Time to be like, hey, everybody, Damiani's moving to Texas? You'd be like, thanks. It would have been nice if I told them, you know, because I'm the one that's moving.
But I think
disrespectful of me to, like, steal that announcement from you or, like, own that? And be like, all right, I just put that out
but
there.
But that you're crossing wires here, though.
That's a different channel.
Yeah, you're talking about, like that's internal corporate relations, but with us, we all work for the same company.
Right.
Like, that could cross, like, lines within, like, business code of conduct or whatever. I wouldn't have had any offense to it. Like, I'd be like, yeah, sure, if Jones wants to start telling people,
right.
That's
it's
cool.
Right, it's not a,
like,
solid argument.
And there's nothing to say, like, companies can still ask a journalist, please don't do this. But if you aren't signing an NDA or an embargo, you're not, like, held, you're not restricted from doing that. You have the option to do that.
Right.
So the option should always be there. However, I feel like if you're an actual journalist and your job is to report on any kind of happening, any kind of news, and I argue that the revelation of a game's existence is news. To me, that has always been news. That's like headline. That's headline news. You learn about a game and you verify it from a source, especially it's a Ubisoft contact telling you about it, and they show you screenshots like, this game exists, they got a report on it. I mean, that I don't know many, like, instances where, I mean, sorry, there are instances where it does ruin a surprise, and I would say those were not controlled leaks, when clearly someone had, like, a big event planned, and, like, shit, like, they would not leak this ahead of, like, a giant event they paid for, like, the whole, like, when the Avengers 2 trailer leaked, like, they did not intentionally do that. They wanted it to be on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., like, to increase the ratings. Like, that
or
was
like
clearly
last year with the Xbox One and all the internal stuff.
So, I mean, there's always the debate of whether something's intentional or not, and there's usually the clues there that you can read between the lines. Like, if X company, who was supposed to make an announcement, is losing money on this being leaked, they probably didn't intentionally leak it. This, even if it's being announced at the Game Awards, now there's discussion, there's expectation for it. We've seen screenshots. If they do reveal it at the Game Awards later tonight or at the PSX conference tomorrow, we get to see it in action and moving. It's like, oh, wow, like, you know, I don't think this disqualifies it from being a controlled leak, the fact that, like, it's ahead of this.
Okay,
I think the thing, too, though, is, like, it's not the journalist's fault for reporting it. It's whoever's telling the journalist about that, right?
Sure.
Like, this isn't coming from an official contact and saying, hey, keep this under your hat, and then he just, like, goes behind their back and does it. This is somebody who is intentionally putting it out there, and if you don't report it, somebody else is, and they're gonna get the scoop from you. So that's kind of where,
the thing is, Kotaku has a continued relationship with Ubisoft.
Yeah.
And here's my next question. If we look at a funny historical incident with Kotaku in the past, they leaked PlayStation Home. And for a while, PlayStation blacklisted Kotaku. They said, fine, we're not telling you anything anymore. You're not getting our stuff anymore. You're blacklisted.
Yeah.
Should Ubisoft blacklist Kotaku? Should Kotaku just say, okay, we now are just officially for the public? Should we just say, we don't sign any NDAs anymore?
At this point, no, that would look terrible, especially since Kotaku's claiming the source was someone from within Ubisoft.
Right.
That would completely burn Ubisoft. They would
never
do that.
If they were blacklisted.
Yeah, no way. Like, that, the amount of hate they would get, especially, they don't want any more hate right now with what they're dealing
with.
You
think blacklisting Kotaku would bring Ubisoft hate?
Oh, of course. At this point, yes, because the source was from Ubisoft.
Right.
So, like, everyone's going to be like, no, so Ubisoft leaks, someone from their own company leaks the stuff, they blacklist Kotaku for it. Like that, like Kotaku would love for that to happen. Like they would, they're probably like hearing that, they're like probably would beg for that to happen because the amount of like publicity they would get from that and the amount of like power they would have over Ubisoft.
It didn't necessarily have to come from Ubisoft. It could have come from a third party marketing source or something.
Okay.
Like that.
Even if it did, like it's still, they did not like, they didn't like hack in anything. They didn't do anything that broke their end of the bargain. Like they didn't sign anything that we know of.
Right.
So they didn't break any rules.
And back to what we learned years ago, when Sony did blacklist Kotaku, they totally made themselves a victim and everyone was on Kotaku's side of that. To the point when Sony finally said, okay, you're not blacklisted anymore. It's like, finally, Sony, you dumb idiots. Like, that was the perspective on that, you know?
Yeah.
Would you blacklist Kotaku if you're at Ubisoft?
No, because it's, again, that would just, there's, you know, it's like you're shooting yourself in the foot.
Yeah.
I guess, like, the moral take from this is I'm really glad I'm not in the scoops business.
Yeah, sure.
That's awesome. Because I don't know. Like I'm not saying like, I mean, if you are, then you're, that's bad. Like if you really like that, that's great. But like, I just feel so dirty. It's like, you look at everybody, like all the people who wrote the script, all the people who did the motion capture and the music and the conceptual design and all of that stuff leading up to Victory. And then some dude's just like, here. And it's like, who are you? Who's this random guy who just jumped in right at the end of development and is now like the only person we're talking about associated with Victory? Now a year from now, when I think about Victory, I'm gonna think about Kotaku. It's like, I don't want to think about you. I just want to think about the people who made this game. I want a direct relationship.
Do you feel that like
who make the
hindered
game.
Your reaction to like first person GTA when all those stories were going around?
I don't remember those stories. Did that leak ahead of time?
Oh yeah.
Really?
Yeah, people were talking about that for a while.
I mean, this is why games press, or not games, but press in general have a bad like rap. Every movie you ever see, like when like the media guy is like harassing the dude with the questions, like the guy punches the cameraman, like this is it. This is like the public perception. Right. Like, but I mean, if you want to be that type of reporter, like you kind of, that's kind of who you need to be. You need to be a little bit more like aggressive, and you're gonna do things that people are gonna like hate you for, because like, you asshole, like. Even if you like are a quote unquote gamer and like you wanted to see the big revel, like let's say they have like they're gonna show off like the new biggest game or whatever at E3, and like you leak it in like a shitty screenshot fashion, and you were going to like say it's gonna be your first E3, I'm going to the press conference, the game's gonna be there, get to see it, and then like someone leaks it on, like you see it on your phone, and you're like, that's cool, but then like you know it's coming, like the surprise is ruined.
Yeah.
Like yeah, like I can see that. Like it does stink sometimes when you like, especially when you're a fan of a certain series, you like, or you enjoy a certain series. Like I want to see this get like the spotlight it deserves. I want to see that big reveal on the stage. I want to see that trailer. I want to see the crowd reaction. I want to see like the forums going nuts with that. I don't want to see like some shitty, like few watermark screenshots on like a site and they got the scoop and that's how we learned the existence of like the game. Like I can see that point of view, but that, I mean, I think that's like the other side of the fence for some people.
I think Kotaku toes a weird line. I mean, they do that, you know, they get review copies of games, I'm assuming that, I'm not positive about that, but they get invited to events officially. So, you know, they do have a working relationship. They also post like, headline, I'm disappointed with the live action film based on this anime. Like, you know, it's Kotaku's a blog sometimes at the same time. And so, like, they're not just scoops. And so they have to do a lot of things. They got to wear a ton of hats, I guess.
They like to post spoilers.
And they like to. Yeah. What are you talking about specifically?
Oh, man, they like their new obsession with GIFs now, like embedded in every single
I love
front
those.
Page.
I honestly love them.
Oh.
So.
I'm glad I watched like Korra like as soon as it goes up, because like within an hour there's always a Kotaku post about the new episode with a gif of something spoiler from it. I'm like, you guys suck. Like this is like this, now you get to understand me. So
yeah.
Reporting okay. Like yeah, an episode's out there, it's free to talk about it, but here's like the other side of the like the coin here. If you actually are a journalist,
Brandon found
it, and you're trying to keep in tune with everything, inevitably you're gonna get spoiled on stuff, because if it's a news bit and it's about a game you like, but like you need to report on it, and it's something like the ending's been leaked, you're kind of like, I feel like you kind of need to take a peek at that news, because like you need to report on it. Sometimes you have to be okay with surprises being ruined and stuff. And so then when, like, you know, we're browsing sites sometimes and I see, like, that damn, like, spoiler, I'm like, I do hate this. Like, that's the moral quandary. Like, sometimes
yeah,
I do hate it. It's like, this, like, especially when it's not even out. Like, when the fucking Naruto shit was spoiled by, like, in Kotaku had a front page article and Michael Huber came and saved me. He goes, do not go to Kotaku today. Like, you will be ruined. Like, go home now, read the rest of the manga online, and then like you're cool to go back on the internet.
So again, it's like that 50-50. It's like, oh, we love games, but like this announcement's mine. It's like, I don't get that. It does not make sense to me. It's like ownership over advertising, and yet at the same time, it's like, oh, we'll write this whole piece on like, wasn't this game great? It's like, well, if that game had been announced, would you steal that one? Would you want to like wedge yourself into everyone's collective memory of that game as opposed to just letting it exist on its own? And like, we separately can exist in the game's media. It's like, I don't like being like, oh, we're a part of this game's development now. So all of a sudden, 24 hours, boom, we're a part of the development team.
The difference is on Kotaku, I can't avoid seeing when they post the spoilers on there. Like, I'm not against posting spoilers, just there either needs to be a chance for you to bail out without the hints. Like, reviews, I don't always get the complaint about reviews. Like, if you're watching a review, this person played the game. I do start lean now that maybe, like, it should just be inherently known. If you're watching a video review, you might see stuff you don't want to see in it. Just like a lot of written reviews for, like, movies, say, or TV episodes, like, warning, if you haven't seen this, go watch it before you read our review, because we're going to discuss stuff. Mm-hmm. So that type of stuff. What Kotaku does sometimes, what I don't like, is there is zero warning. The headline in the image you see immediately is the spoiler. There's no way of getting around it. And other sites do that too. That, I think, is like, you don't need to do that. That is in service of getting clicks and, like, you know, getting people angry to tell everyone about it, generate discussion. Like, if you're really doing it, you'd give like a, you know, you'd warn the audience, like, hey, there's a bit of news in here that you might want to know about, but we're telling you now it's a spoiler. So we're giving you a chance to not click on this.
They're not going
to
do that.
They're not going to do that. That's where I say that's bullshit. That's where you shouldn't be doing that.
Yeah, we've trashed on the Kotaku. Collar,
first story topic on GT's then.
We trashed them enough. We've poor Kotaku. All right. Okay, we got another news story about basically ideal launches, ideal releases, how to give out information. Game of Thrones, Iron from Ice, I believe is the subtitle.
Yep.
Iron from Ice, the Telltale game. Was announced, I mean, sorry, the release date was announced on Thanksgiving last week.
Yep.
Came out this week.
Yep.
I think 5 days later, after the announcement.
That's how Telltale rolls.
That's like how they roll. Do we like that? Is that cool?
No.
Their PR guys don't like it. They haven't slept.
Sorry?
Their PR guys don't like it. They haven't slept.
They haven't slept. What do you mean?
They're also hiring if you want a job in Marin County. I've been told to let everyone know that Telltale is hiring.
You heard it here first. Wait, what positions are they hiring for?
I think it's their PR team, beginning of next year, yeah.
Okay.
Because they're like two guys that like handle worldwide like distribution and review codes and all that craziness.
And they're pulling their hair out because on Thanksgiving Day, the release date is announced and they have to let everyone know.
Yeah.
And then the
and
next
then get
week
codes
it's out.
Out to everybody, yeah.
Yeah. So do we think, I mean, all we can do is guess, do we think that it was kind of like a, this will shock them, we'll just do release date and then launch it, and then that'll be like a huge thing? Or do you think that this was probably a South Park style, working up to it to the last minute kind of game? Did they not know when they could have put a release date on this, is what I'm asking.
I feel kind of like they just, okay, it's done, let's put it out.
Yeah.
I think that they just, like, they're, you know, and there's some indie developers that are kind of like that too. It's like, well, why would I keep people from playing my game? I could put it out there right now.
I freaking love it. I love that kind of thing. Do you all love that too? Damiani's sour about this.
I think that was too... I think Telltale in general, like, I know they're like strapped and stuff, but I feel in the last few like releases of the first episode of new series, it's just way too sudden. Like, we know it's coming, but like from the perspective of people trying to cover the games, especially reviewing, it's just too quick. I feel like they should at least give 2 weeks would be enough for us. But like when it's within days, it's like, especially over a holiday break, it's like, thanks guys. Like, what do you expect? I know they're really short. They're not that long each episode, so it's not totally unreasonable. I just feel like they could do a little bit more build up to it. Like if you gave themselves like this, a week, you know, like a little bit more lead time. Like, we finished it. We have it done. All right, let's put like a, let's just do one last push for this. Like, here's the release date. It's coming out, and it's not tomorrow. It's like, it's gonna be like 2 weeks. I feel like it just loses a little bit like of the, speaking of the, like from the thought of like a publisher, I think you're doing a little bit of a disservice. I feel like you could give it a better push out the door if you prepared it a little bit more. I just feel like it's cool to, like, anyone wants to play it, like, oh man, it's, they just finished it, we're getting it now, that's cool. But I just don't know how many people, like, really, I mean, they got a lot of backing from HBO, like, they were retweeting it and posting on Facebook. But if it was, like, it was another series, like, the Wolf Among Us, it's like, what, how much push can, is, like, you know, are they really getting for anyone retweeting that? Like, they could have given us, like, you know, or they could have given themselves a little bit better, like, chance to promote the game. Like, I feel like, what's the discussion around this game? Like, the discussion's not going to happen until people start saying, oh, it's great, it's, like, you know, goaty material and stuff. It's just weird. It's, like, different from, like, other releases where there's, like, you know, the release date a few months in advance. We're getting close to it. You see, like, the marketing and stuff. Like,
yeah, I didn't bring this up.
It's weird.
We didn't have trailers. We had a teaser trailer, I think, a couple of weeks before the announcement of the release date. Until then, we just had a title announcement.
Right.
And do you remember, I guess it was VGX last year, there were some people from Telltale talking about it. They sat on the chair, the couch with Jeff, and just, like, talked about what their plans were. Had nothing to show of the game. And then a year later, it finally comes out very suddenly at the end.
Yeah, it does feel like a last minute thing. But, like, I gotta admit, I love the look on my wife's face. I'm, like, sitting in my kitchen. I'm like, oh, guess what you're gonna play tomorrow? Game of Thrones. She was like, what?
Did you
just
play?
Just, like, stopped what she was doing. Oh, yeah.
So do you like, is it good? Does it hold up? Does it feel rushed?
It's great. No. Well, all their games kind of feel rushed. Like, there's, my favorite is, like, the, like, teleporting NPC. Where I'll be, like, having a conversation, and then, like, the frame will start, and nobody's there, and he's like, hey, so anyway, it's like, what was that? You know, so, like, there are weird things. I had, like, the throne room, like, vanished at one point. Somebody was, like, walking with Tyrion, and the background just, like, totally did a weird, like, shift. So, like, but I think that's, like, acceptable losses. I think they're, like, you're not playing this game. You're not playing this game for, like, a photorealistic Cersei Lannister. Like, Cersei's, that's the best we can make Cersei look. End of story. Like,
Abba Bappa.
What?
That's your...
You have to watch Final Boss.
Acceptable bugginess.
Oh, right.
And yeah. Brokenness and poor performance allowance. Right. There's just some things you're going to be saying, you know what, I'll deal with Abba Bappa. You know, like, that's fine with that.
Well, you really have to figure out what are they playing the game for.
Right.
You know? And you're playing the game for the story. And the writing is great. I like how it's, I'm not to get into Game of Thrones discussion, but I like there's multiple characters. That's something that they've done. And that was a curiosity of mine when I first started up. I'm like, I hope I'm playing somebody else. I hope I'm just not this squire, like, the whole time. I'm actually hoping in episode 2 that we play 3 new, totally different characters. I think that would be really cool. But I could totally see this as a game that it was literally finished, like, yesterday. Or, like, a couple days ago, and then they just cut, print, release. And because they got their hands in so many different things right now. You know, we're waiting on the episodic installments for both Tales of the Borderlands and this. So, yeah, I think just get it out the door, get money coming back in, as opposed to us spending more money. Because we're not just spending money on the next part, we're spending money on episodes, I think it was 6 parts.
Mm-hmm.
So this is like for 5 more parts for Game of Thrones. And so it's like we got to make our balance sheets equal out a little bit.
Yeah, I got to say, I actually really like it. I like, I don't want the 2 weeks. I don't want it extended. I don't want to know about Assassin's Creed Victory over a year before it comes out, or under a year, I guess. But... Blood, what's your opinion on that? What's the appropriate teaser trailer to launch date announcement to launch? Is there such a thing? Does this work because it's called Game of Thrones and they don't need that much awareness? Is it that
kind
of factor?
I think it feels sort of like they were just, there's like almost a fear of like, oh, well, one can, because, you know, like, you've got to schedule this with, like, PSN and Xbox Live, like, they've all kind of have to be in sync, and you have to work that out. And so it's like, so they had, like, as soon as they got the green light, then that's when it happened. But it's strange to me that you're coordinating with all of those guys and with HBO, and you don't know that far ahead enough to, like, be able to start telling people, you know? It's,
I guess, 5 days.
Yeah.
I guess that's, like, the shortest. Yeah. It's, you could possibly do that.
But, yeah, I mean, those things kind of, sometimes they seem really cool, and sometimes it's just like, oh, okay, and then the game just kind of comes out and bombs. Like, what, Excitebots? What was it on the Wii? Like, was announced and then was out with, like, 5 or 6 weeks of the announcement.
Yeah, what a time. When the Wii was new, any game for the Wii.
It wasn't even new at that point. That was, like, a year or two later.
All right, because we had Excite Trucks first.
Yeah.
And then Excitebots was the sequel. Yeah, oh my god.
I think length also has something to do with it.
It's a short game.
It's a $5 game. You know, you can beat it in night, you know, if you really hustle through it.
Mm-hmm.
And So it's not something where it like pops up and you're like, what, that's out today?
Yeah.
And you're like, well, like, first of all, it's like, I don't have time to play that, you know? So like, man, what am I gonna fit that into my schedule? I kind of resent that now. I would have liked to like get amped for that and like maybe take work off or like not plan to go to my friend's birthday party.
Yeah, even the show, they like, it's all planned out. Like you see those ads up for months. It's like coming back and, you know, and this is the date and you get ready.
Here's a crow with a bunch of eyes.
Yeah, I just think when it's too short of notice, you don't give enough time to reach as many people as you can. Like the more lead time you give to building up to a release of something, the better chance you have of reaching more people to inform them that this is coming out.
You're right. Yeah.
I don't know if, like, as you said, like this is a short, like, you know, very cheap game, like cost wise. So I don't know if they really cared too much about that, and they were planning maybe it's just gonna be word of mouth. Like we don't care if this is a slow burn. Like maybe that's what they're used to with all their games. Like maybe they see the majority of the sales actually when all the episodes are finally out and you can just buy it all at once. Like some people might wait to play it that way. Maybe they've done it so much that like they know this is the best strategy for them. But thinking about like other, like when I was saying earlier, other things, and even like, yeah, like when you're saying the show, you want the whole hype train process is building up so as many people can be aware that on this date, this is the event. You're tuning in for this. You're going to the store to buy this because this is when it comes out. You've made people aware.
And you know what? This is really sad. Psychologically, human beings like wanting something. We love wanting things.
Oh, yeah, baby.
Yeah. And, like, that's a whole part of you're right.
Yeah, you make people wait for something. They want it more.
But I wanted to PAX. I went to PAX, and had the banners up, and I was like, oh, my God, I can't wait.
But here's the other thing to me that's weird about the whole Telltale thing. They have an episodic structure, right?
Right.
You never know in the next episode. Like, you would not do that on TV. It's like, first episode of Game of Thrones coming out, and then, you know, we'll get the second episode when it's done. No, it's like you would want to, like, especially now that they've done so many, like, you would want to plan out a schedule, and I think you would release the first episode when you're, like, done with episode 4. You know?
Right.
And then that way you can, like, polish up, maybe tweak some things along the way, but, like, you're almost done with the season, and so then you can, you know,
It depends.
That.
I didn't play season 2 of Walking Dead, and I've yet to play Wolf Among Us because I wanted them to be done. I wanted it to be like, all right, I got a weekend. I got the whole collection on one disc. Let's do this. Let's
but it's like, you know, if you
I play Game of Thrones because it was Game of Thrones. I'm like, I have to play this now.
If I could play, you know, episode 1 weekend, and then episode 2 the next weekend, and then episode, and then like actually have like feel like a real season rather than like, oh, I don't know when this is going to be done.
I think that hasn't happened yet with an episodic game, you know, where it has that consistent, like, we're going to do episodes at a really consistent pace. It's just video games are different because the temples disappear behind people, you know?
I wonder if they're trying to get it out maybe so they can finish all 6 episodes before season 6, right?
Yep.
6? Season 6 starts?
Yeah, I hope so.
Okay.
So then people that are like, they like see the trailers for season 6 and they're like, I got it, something.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, right. There's that thing that
My
I didn't
squire.
Care about, but all of a sudden, man, I got to do it.
Yeah.
And then there's, hey, 4 episodes. You can check it out, or 5 or 6.
Maybe big news this week. Maybe potentially big news this week. I don't know about this. Steam has announced a beta in which you will be able to stream Steam games straight from Steam. You just click, hey, I'm streaming this. They're making their own Twitch, is what's happening.
It's not going to Twitch? They have their own
streaming service.
Yeah, that's the one big difference. I would say this is a good thing because we saw how successful it's been on PlayStation 4.
But PlayStation 4 does use Twitch.
The thing I would say is the one thing that I don't know, I think it will change at some point, I think they'll give in, is that I don't understand why Valve is insistent. They always like to keep things within their own systems and stuff. That's like the whole purpose of like Steam. I do feel like they're kind of missing the boat in that, no offense, like, Twitch is Twitch. No one else is good at dethrone Twitch right now.
No offense.
And sorry, Valve, like, you're not, unless you decide to like buy it from Amazon, you're not gonna offer something that's gonna be more popular than Twitch right now. And a lot of their users are gonna be like, I wanna stream this to Twitch. Those who can already do it are gonna keep doing it, I feel like.
Like Dota 2 players probably will still stay on Twitch.
I think there'll be a more specialized use for it that I've yet to see that might work within like the Steam's system, that maybe they do like some kind of like viewing experience that's only possible if you're on Steam that isn't possible on Twitch, which would be a good use of this new service. But otherwise, it's good that they're offering it. It's a first step. Now, if you don't have like something, like especially if you don't have like the was it NVIDIA, the Shadow Play or whatever it's called, that lets you just stream any of your games that you play on your computer, or you don't have a software like XSplit or OBS, this is a way now you just have just have Steam to start streaming.
Yeah.
So I feel like maybe I don't know how they're gonna like monetize or anything, if they're gonna do anything with that, but it's good because it's like they're getting this is what their games like have mass appeal. Like a lot of the Steam games are some of the most popular, and some of Valve's own games are the most popular games to be streamed.
Yeah. You're Gabe Newell. Dota 2 championships are coming up. Do you let Twitch stream that, or do you say, "Hey, everyone, just watch it here on Steam"? Do you say that?
I guess it just kind of depends on, like what they're. I mean, I just feel like I know so little about it right now. It's a weird thing because I feel like you have an audience on Twitch. Well, yeah, like when you get Twitch front page, like that's a big deal. People come in and see that wouldn't normally watch that, but it's like, oh, I'm looking for something on Twitch, this is active, let me check it out. Whereas on Steam, like, okay, now you have to curate, now you have to get like people invested in looking there too.
However, your entire market's on Steam. If you are Valve, you got Dota 2.
Yeah.
Everyone who could potentially play that game is on Steam right now.
But there are a lot of people that couldn't play that game that would watch that game, I would think.
Well, you don't care about them. It's a free-to-play game. Why aren't you playing it yet?
I think the difference, one idea I can see is just the level of access you can get to what you're watching on a Steam stream versus Twitch. When you think of it, like the Steam service, like when you think of like you're talking about like Dota 2 championships.
Yeah.
You're gonna have a big production. You have like a studio. You're gonna have people on camera. You have like the lighting, the audience. That's more like a Twitch production. I don't think that's what they're gonna be going for with like the Steam streaming service.
Yeah.
What you can't think of, the best analogy I can do, I think, is like with a sports game. When you're watching a live like football game, you can only see what the cameras are showing you. You go camera one, you're seeing like the wide shot of the field. Camera two, you see like the close up of the quarterback about to take the snap. Camera three is like the wide receiver catching it. You don't, unless like this is like the Steam streaming might be the equivalent of like not just being like at like the event, but like being able to see through anyone's eyes. So
each individual player because, on stream.
Yeah, so when you see a bunch of players playing the game and you're doing the stream, you could go to any, I think how it works is you go to anyone's profile and if they're in streaming mode, you can see exactly what they are seeing. So you, the user, have control of going into whatever you want to see. So if you're trying to learn strategy, it's like, I want to scrutinize this player. On Twitch, you're at the mercy of the streamer.
The director.
The director, yeah, essentially. Whereas this, you could do whatever you want. Your viewing experiences of whatever's live, you can go to that feed and do it. I think that might be the hook. Or if I was them, I'd be like, this is the hook we can offer that Twitch can't do right now.
You're saying, so like when you're in spectator mode within a game. Yeah, I think that could be a cool application.
Which is great for Steam, but not great for each person's individual profile. You know, it's like, if I'm one of those individual players, and it's like, no, I want everything to be about me. I want you to come to my channel and watch my stuff. And it's like, well, I'm bouncing all over the place. And like, if they really want this to be competitive with Twitch, you have to have these giant profiles be like, okay, screw Twitch, I'm moving over to Steam now. And like, who's gonna do that? Like, who's gonna just like, oh, all these followers, all these people that subscribe to me, that follow me on Twitch, bye.
Yeah.
I'm going to this new service now. Like, nobody's gonna do that.
One even smaller use that I actually think is the best one is when you're on a games page, potentially buying the game, you can go and look at somebody who's streaming it right now.
Great.
Yeah.
I think that's genius. I think that's very, very cool.
But again, I'm not paying attention to where I'm going. I'm not going to remember that name of that guy streaming.
Oh, no, yeah. That's like the micro side. That's like that person will never be internet famous, but you're...
So if you're making a game, great. Yeah. If you're a aspiring Twitch streamer player, no.
Right.
Yeah, but that kind of thing, too. It's not like it can't be done without, without Steam. I mean, because that's basically what the PlayStation service. You look and see what people are streaming and...
Oh, you're right. You absolutely could do that.
So, I think what Mike's talking about is probably a little bit more interesting, and Twitch would have to catch up to be able to do that, to be able to, like, look at a match and then look at anybody that's inside of that match.
Yeah, I mean, Steam is they're in beta with this plan. They're not quite there yet, but maybe they'll get there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Twitch presentation, you either need to hook up to everyone's like computer to get their feeds, like you need like something like a TriCaster to do that, versus this where it's already built in infrastructure. Like it just makes it easier to give you the type of access to any of the feeds, I think. And that's something, like, Twitch could do that, but, like, not everyone could do it. Even if I was streaming, like, X game, and other people were competing with me, if they didn't give me access to their feed, or I didn't have access to their feed somehow, I couldn't even do that if I wanted to. So that's the one thing here. I think this will be more self-serving to Steam and Valve itself to help promote its games, and, and other other publishers promote their games. I don't think this is necessarily, this is not to serve the individual to become, you know, popular. Like, Twitch is still going to be the place you go if you want to be known as, like, a streamer or a caster, essentially. If you're trying to help, if you're a developer and you're trying to get your product done well, you, or more well known, you could do something creative with, like, we're doing, like, a tournament for this game, like, you know, on Steam, like Steam French page. Like, you go in there, you see it, you know.
Also, like you said, if you're just a person, you want to share, you just want to stream, just click stream. If you're just a regular person, like, that's a great way to stream, maybe it sounds like. To wrap up our show, I want to do a lightning round of yes or no and why. Got a
few
of these.
Why part doesn't make it lightning?
It does. You got to do your why in one or two sentences. Brandon's very good at that.
Thank you, Kyle.
Earlier this morning, I saw a gaff thread about a Paper Mario for Wii U listing showing up on Walmart. Do you believe? Yes or no and why, Brandon?
No.
Sorry. Do you want to believe? Do you want to believe that exists, Paper Mario for Wii U?
No, because I see headlines like that all the time for games that don't come out.
Daniel Bloodworth, yes or no and why?
Yes, because I think it's timing makes sense.
Michael Damiani, do you want to believe, yes or no, and why?
Yes, because I think there's always been a console Paper Mario since they started coming out. So there'll be one on Wii U.
But why do you want to believe?
I think they can make another one that's as good as the Thousand Year Door or N64 one again.
Can I say no because I'm scared it'll be like that 3DS one?
You can say that, but you're casual, because that game wasn't that bad.
Yes, it was.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, you're going to get me started on Miyamoto again.
Mr. Stickers.
Oh, coming in saying, no new characters. Don't you make new characters
stickers.
In a Paper Mario game. Oh, I always want to.
Like
okay, No Man's Sky was on Game Informer's cover this week. Do you like what Game Informer does with its covers? Brandon Jones, yes or no and why?
Yes, because, again, it's all about marketing and kind of distilling the excitement around an announcement into an image, much like a trailer, which I also enjoy.
Daniel Bloodworth, yes or no and why?
I guess it's the way to, if you're gonna run a magazine, you better have something that's actually new and not 2 weeks old, so sure.
Michael Damiani, do you like what they do with the covers, yes or no?
Yes, because their covers generally look good.
Yeah,
they're nice covers. I'm tired, like, print's dying, but I'm glad that someone tries to do, like, gets original artwork from the game creators and makes it, like, they're spread, like, both front and back, usually. Like, when you unfold it, it's like a giant piece of artwork. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, that used to bum me out the most, actually, is when I was getting a magazine that had just, like, promo art on the cover. Because I love, like, the custom covers. And I
all the text and, like, columns and, like, square images.
You're right,
other
Game Informer has classy covers. Okay, Konami is releasing 2008's Metal Gear Solid 4 digitally on PS3 this month. Do you think it holds up? Metal Gear Solid 4. Brandon Jones, yes or no and why?
I didn't play it.
Do you think it holds up, that game from 2008?
Sure.
Why?
Because it's a huge game with tons of cutscenes and they put a lot of work into it.
Hey man, that's your sentences. Daniel Bloodworth, yes or no and why?
Yes, I mean, it holds up about as well as when it came out.
Michael Damiani, yes or no and why?
I'm going to say yes. I kind of wished you would ask if this was pointless or not, because I think... I don't know why they made an announcement about this.
If it's like, pointless, then you should say no.
No, who cares about it being available digitally at this point? Like, whatever.
It is weird. It's totally weird to do that.
Anyway, yes, I think it holds up because, you know, I'd rather play it any day of the week over Ground Zeroes.
I wish I could ask and why to that, but that is the end of that segment.
Good.
Ouch. You would rather play that game? You know what? No, that's fine. We got to end this episode.
Did you not play that final boss battle?
What final boss battle? Oh, of Metal Gear Solid 4. I thought you were talking about Ground Zeroes.
Yeah, Ground Zeroes didn't have a final boss battle.
The final boss battle is mashing square.
What?
Yeah, that is the final boss of Metal Gear Solid 4. Yeah. Yeah, it is.
Oh.
Oh, boy.
You know what?
Street Fighter.
You got 2 more weeks after this. We're not going to get into it. We're not going to fight.
The different eras of Ocelot. Go away.
That's not the last thing that... Okay.
Throw yourself off the Arsenal gear or whatever.
PSX and Game Awards. Big thing happening this weekend. That's huge. Those two are huge events that, you know, again, also kind of like unexpected, you know, and they just kind of popped up.
Oddly enough, only one of us on this couch is going.
Who's going?
Brandon.
Cool. Brandon, are you going to like shake a lot of hands and meet people?
I hope so.
Yeah. Friend Brandon, go over and shake his hands. Both of them, apparently. Next week, we're doing our bet now. I'm going to Wikipedia next week. I'm going to look at the list of all of the PS4 games. Mm-hmm. For some reason, they keep free-to-play games a separate list. We're not counting that in this bet. Look at all the PS4 games. Currently, there are 24 games on this list that start with the word "the." At this point next week, how many games will there be on that list that start with the word "the"? Michael Damiani, this is a big one this week. You may go first or last.
I'll go last. And yes. Lightning round, yes.
Wait, what?
I'll go last.
Okay.
I was trolling you.
You said PS4 games?
PS4 games.
I'll go with 27.
There will be three new games with the word "the" at the end of the weekend. Brandon Jones.
I'll go, I was gonna say 27, I'll go 26.
Okay. Oh my God, this is so tense. This is so tense. Because we know it's The Last Guardian, obviously. And so, like, maybe, you know, like, The Elder Scrolls? What other "thes" could there be?
Considering Bethesda said nothing would be there.
So it's 25. The Last Guardian's the only "the" game.
So Mike basically sweeps whatever the top range is.
Damn, it's really tempting to say,
you could say 24.
Yeah, because it could be 24. That's what, I'm surprised you wanted to go last.
Do expansions count? Are those show up on that list?
How do you mean?
Well, like they announced the expansion to GTA 5, whatever that's going to be.
That'll
they
count.
They announced the Lost in Dance GTA 5.
I mean,
if it shows up on the list.
Yeah, we don't control the list. We don't control the list. It's all on that Wikipedia page.
Oh, yeah, it could be.
What?
Good. Ah, damn.
Damiani, everyone who's listening,
I'm not really convinced there's any game that's going to be announced to have "the" in the title of it.
24. Do it.
Trying to think. I don't think that Square Enix RPG will have "the"
in the title of it. I know there's like 70 freaking games at the show and at least 3 or 4 unannounced titles.
I guess it depends how many unannounced titles are actually going to be there.
Yeah. Wow, he's really putting a lot of thought.
I think I already lost this one.
He's going to make this one count.
I'll just go high. One above, whatever.
Which would be 28.
Sure.
Okay, let me lock those in.
Pretty sure I lost.
So what, you wanted 24? You should have gone first is what you should have done, I guess.
Yeah.
That was a tough bet. Last week, you weren't here, Damiani. We had a really weird one. I'm curious, really quick, a lightning round. I want to know what you would have bet. Least popular amiibo on Amazon.com.
Oh, Yoshi.
Oh, that's a good bet. That's a
wow.
But Yoshi did great, actually. Least popular is Pit. Nobody guessed Pit. We should have
known. Pit was on
there. We should have known he would have been least popular.
Yeah.
The winning bet was Villager. Brandon, you bet Marth, which I think was a really good bet, but I think he's one of the exclusive figurines to like Best Buy or something.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
So they gave Mike a list of our options, man.
Yeah, it wasn't on Amazon. It wasn't the list ranked on Amazon. So that means I win again. What blood?
Stuff like that, you've got to start giving us lists when you get a specific, like, what's on it. Like, I don't know what's on Amazon versus what's on something else.
And with that one in particular, I didn't write it down. That was an audible I called in that moment, least popular amiibo.
Wait, the least pop, okay. Yeah. I mean, technically, the least popular amiibo would be one that's not on.
I said I was going to go to the list. I was going to go to Amazon.com and click by rank by popularity and go to the bottom of the list. I couldn't have been more clear about that. Yoshi's doing fine.
The bottom of the list was the empty space where Marth should have been.
I guess I said Yoshi because I saw the photos of the retail stores with like tons of Yoshis and nothing
else.
Oh,
that's so sad. Poor Yoshi. Link is still number one. You can't top Link, apparently. Everybody wants a little Link toy.
Not with him jumping high like that. You can't get anything over him.
Did you order yourself a Link amiibo?
Yes, I still have it.
Did you have a Zelda amiibo?
It hasn't been released yet, but I pre-ordered it.
You're going to get a Sheik amiibo.
I have Sheik and... what's the other one named?
Toon Link?
Yes, those two.
Mm. I love that he's buying all of these.
The
Zelda ones.
It's like pot odds. It's like Damiani has so much in Zelda invested at this point that he can't stop. His value of this will be less if he stops buying new Zelda things. It has to be complete.
Oh, so you're not buying all the amiibos, just the Zelda ones?
Just the Zelda ones.
Okay. Yeah.
I bought all the Link Between Worlds soundtrack. Okay. For once in a long time, I didn't realize that was announced in September for Club Nintendo Japan. I just saw a Facebook feed that it existed. I was like, wait, what? Man,
Link Between Worlds, the 3DS game.
Yeah.
Cool.
So the Club Nintendo Japan has a 2-disc soundtrack.
They get all the cool stuff. They get all the cool stuff. How much did you spend on that?
Like $38.
That's a good price.
How much is that in yen?
No, like US, like my paid $38.
Everyone, the video I want to promote is, you know what I should do? We should do our live streams. Michael Damiani and I are doing before and after the Game Awards. We're doing our, you know, we're going to talk about what's
going to happen. You're watching, they're actually watching it right now. They're not watching us on GT Time because they're watching our pre-show right now.
You're watching GT right now. If you're watching GT Time and it's Friday evening, are you doing?
All right, well, fine.
Stop watching this and come watch our live stream
right
now.
There's a big keynote that's happening Saturday morning for PSX. Bloodworth's going to be with me on that one. Because Damiani said he didn't want to come in on Saturday morning.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to be coming in anyways. So, yeah, I'll just hop onto the stream after I'm done with what I'm
doing. Yeah, finish packing more shit.
Like your Zelda amiibos.
Yeah.
Actually, those are being shipped to my new address. I was like, please don't send that stuff. I don't need any more crap to back up.
So you're sending... Oh, I
got
see.
Angry because I forgot to change the Kingdom Hearts game I pre-ordered forever ago. I forgot to change the address on that, so it got shipped to my current apartment. I was like, damn it, I don't need another game to pack right now. I meant to send
You're never even going to play that game. You just reviewed it.
Yeah. No, I want to get all the platinum trophies and stuff.
Are you dead serious?
Yeah.
I forgot you get platinums. You got the platinum in Ni No Kuni.
Yeah.
We learned that very early in GT Time history. And I was like, wow, Damiani gets his platinums. So you're going to get the platinum in Kingdom Hearts 2.
It also helped that I reviewed Recoded and Birth by Sleep for GT 2.
What? Why did that help?
I already played the games.
Yeah, so you should stop buying them. You're wasting your money.
No, I'm playing them in HD.
You realize the GT Time theme is playing throughout this entire... Like, people are like... they get a sense that the conversation is wrapping up when the music starts.
Man, this is already...
Everyone, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. Here's everyone's Twitter names. Follow them on Twitter. Damiani, while you can. He's got 2 more weeks after this. Like, get those tweets follows in while you can, Damiani.
Oh, yeah, wait.
What?
Oh, maybe we should announce it later.
What?
Oh, I'll announce it in my last one. The whole, the Pack South thing.
It's too late.
Now you've announced
it's too late to not announce it
now. Can you edit it out?
We can't. I promise you, Ian is not willing to
do that. Oh, well, we're having a Pack South panel at Pack South.
Oh, what'd you get? What's the panel?
Yeah, we're doing I get to a Pop Fiction panel, apparently.
Very, very cool. All right, we'll go into more detail on that if you ever win a bet. If you ever win a bet, you can do that. Totals. Brandon's at 6. I am now at 8. One beneath Damian at 9. Bloodworth still at 12.
Brandworth.
Everyone, thank you for putting up with the show. I deeply appreciate it, and we hope to see you again next week. Bye.
I love
Damiani, instead of what's in your mug, quickly say what's wrong with the Terminator movie.
You want me to say? You want me to say the phrase? What's wrong with it?
Yeah, yeah, very quickly. What's wrong with the new Terminator?
I want to explain why.
Yeah, very quickly.
Okay, so they released Terminator Genesis.
Yeah.
Spelled really dumb, by the way.
Yeah.
It basically seems like they're retconning out Terminator 1 and 2 from being imported in existence. The trailer is straight up Terminator 1 again. They're recreating it. And then Sarah Connor. So the beginning of Terminator 1, the whole thing where Kyle Reese is like, you know, naked in an alley, gets chased by the cops, goes into the department store, gets on some clothes.
Yeah.
They show that going on, and then as he's like hiding behind a corner like he did in the first movie, armored truck crashes through, hits the police officer, very similar shots to Terminator 2, when they're trying to break out of Cyberdyne, and then Daenerys Stormborn opens the door and goes, come with me if you want to live. But I think I heard, where's my dragons? And then Kyle Reese is like, huh? What's going on? And then the cop is a T-1000 and starts chasing them. And it's like, what's going on here? Like, why is this all like, why are you like a battle-hardened person all of a sudden? I thought you were supposed to be this helpless mother. Like, oh no, we already took care of the Terminator sent through time. Like, who's we? Old Arnold Schwarzenegger walks up to like a CG version of his original version Terminator and boom, shoots him. And then like there's an Arnold, get to the chopper missile dive moment, like where he jumps out of the helicopter like Robert Patrick did. Apparently Robert Patrick's in there in a cameo shot in a room where someone blasted the wall. So much bad shit going on in this movie.
Everything you just described sounds great.
No, this is like bad.
Okay, bye everybody.
Thanks.